Welcome to the 4C Fitness Show, starring Michelle and Lisa Cast, live from Skinny Man 31 Studios in the heart of Times Square, New York. And now, here are your hosts, Michelle and Lisa Cast.
I like to let Brittany do her thing.
Sometimes it sounds like it's just going to go on forever.
And I love it. Hi, guys. Welcome to the 4C Fitness Show. It is Tuesday, March 18th, 2014. And this is episode 28. We're almost 30.
Oh, boy. Sorry, I'm just Instagramming here.
If you caught us when we started broadcasting live, we were tweeting and Instagramming and shouting out that we were about to hit the airwaves. Is that the way to say it?
I think so.
Today's show, our 28th episode, is all about the additional benefits of exercise. Really excited about today's show. We actually read an article that our friend Tila posted last week, and it was all about how exercise makes you happy and gives you amazing endorphins, and it's a real thing, and I'm sure you've heard it before. So we thought it'd be great to focus the whole show about that. And we thought that it might motivate you to get physical more often, aside from just weight loss.
Let's get physical.
That's right.
Physical. I wanna hear physical.
I'm just moving on to the next verse.
Okay, sorry.
Let me hear your endorphins rock. So we figured this would be a motivational way to get you going, aside from just worrying about the way you look, more so the way you feel.
That's right. For those of you joining us for the first time, I'm Lisa. Michelle introduced the show. And we began our weight loss journey back in 2008 when we auditioned for The Biggest Loser. We almost made the show, but because we didn't, we decided to take matters into our own hands and lose the weight all on our own. And since then, we've lost 240 pounds combined.
Yes, we have.
Bam.
So if you're tuning in for the first time, or if you've been following us for a while and you haven't heard our mission statement before, we like to share for our new viewers and to remind everyone who's been following along. 4C Fitness is a health and fitness resource and web show. We forge partnerships with other health and fitness professionals and enthusiasts to bring a variety of sustainable information to our followers as the fitness world continues to grow and change. Our mantra is the 4Cs: choose, commit, challenge, and change. We feel these four components are the key to creating a successful, healthy lifestyle. And like I said, we want to thank everyone who has been tuning in and welcome our new viewers. And hopefully we are bringing you what it is that you're interested in. And at any time, you can feel free to reach out to us. And if there's a specific topic you want to know more about, we will bring that to you. So, yeah.
Thanks, Michelle.
Yeah.
On to the noteworthy news segment this week. Kinetic.com is up, which it's a really awesome site.
It's really
I really
cool.
love it a lot. Yeah. It's just all fitness all the time, which is really nice, like a social media for just fitness. So it sort of like weeds out all the rest. You know, if you're just looking for, you know, recipes and inspiration and motivation and just, and they also have experts on there.
I was going to note too, though, like, you could also do that on Pinterest, but the thing that drives me crazy about Pinterest is not just health and fitness.
Right.
So, like, you could see a totally horrible recipe that, like, totally derails you.
Right.
But at least on Kinetic, it's like-minded people, really.
Exactly. And you're getting that support of, okay, so this is a pancake recipe that is not totally gonna throw me.
Maybe it's, you know, paleo or something
yeah.
like that.
So there's some really cool people on there. Check it out. Yeah. Kinetic.com. That's Kinetic.com.
And we saw...
We saw Eric.
I'm like, which one? Brandon?
One of the co-founders of Kinetic.
Yeah, last week, which was awesome at a spin class, but we'll get into that more. SportsCenter will be on our show on April 1st. Really excited to see them again. SportsCenter is really, really cool website that's going to be launching. Actually, it's up already, but the actual mobile app will be launching the end of this month. Mm-hmm. I haven't heard if it came out yet, but it should be coming soon.
Yes.
And basically what they'll do is if you put in your profile what it is that you're interested in and where you are, whether it's yoga, Pilates, CrossFit, you can purchase a membership to give you passes to try different places around the city. For now, it's going to be just in New York, and then hopefully they'll expand. But you should definitely check out sportscenter.com. There's no charge to just check it out. And I believe you get a free month if you check it out right now. but okay. I don't know the exact details on that. So, and Jacqueline and Lisa and I are supposed to go check out Jacqueline from SportsCenter, mm-hmm. the baseball center over here on yes. the Upper West Side to go.
I'm excited about that.
A little batting practice, yeah.
Yeah. Chase Infinite is a really cool fitness apparel company that we've connected with. And if you want to purchase any great fitness apparel, very motivational stuff, really cute stuff, yeah, use the code FITNESS to get 20% off. And each purchase, a dollar is donated to either the National Coalition Against Domestic Violence, the American Heart Association, or Roswell Park Cancer. So you're not only looking good, but you're also donating to good causes.
Absolutely. And Power Ice, we haven't forgotten about you. We just have not had a chance to do our trying them out and review and giveaway, but stay tuned. If you're interested in more about Power Ice, let us know, but we will have that up soon.
So moving on to the Energy Bits, we are ambassadors for Energy Bits. And you can use the code FourC, FOURC, to get 30% off a purchase of a bag of Energy Bits.
That is a huge discount, and Energy Bits are so amazing, and we actually have them.
We do. We're going to take them right now.
So you guys can see the difference. I'm actually feeling a little tired right now from a long day.
I am not for some reason, but I'm going to take these anyway.
You'll see we have a dose of 30 little green tabs in our hands. We'll share a photo on our blog. Shauna, you want some?
Do you want to show them?
Here.
Just crack that open and show it up to the camera.
You can take those. You need a bunch of water, though. Or you could use beer. So you just swallow the whole handful.
Just twist it. Twist the cap.
Yeah.
There you go. You want to show the camera?
Show the tin.
It's little green pellets.
They kind of smell like fish food, but...
Don't smell.
Yeah. He smelled them.
All right, so here we go. Ready?
Everybody take your bits. Yeah, there's less than 30 there.
But that's okay. Yeah. It'll do something.
Ready?
Wait, I'll have them all in my mouth. Go ahead, Michelle. You swallow them faster than I do.
Excuse the silence. We all just took our bits. Sean's like, I just swallowed a lot of pills with beer. So basically, they're not going to have any side effects with your beer because they're just pure protein algae. You can see the green residue left in there. The top is the really cool Energy Bits logo. Yeah. So usually they take only about 5 to 10 minutes to kick in. And we'll let you guys know if we feel a difference. We've only taken them for exercise, but mm-hmm. people take them for anything. They take them instead of coffee or tea. So we had thought that it would be fun to share with you guys live on a show.
And it takes me about 5 to 10 minutes to swallow.
Yes, I can see that. They do recommend you take them with plenty of water.
Right. So because they're pure protein. So yeah. Energy Bits, 4C is the 30% off code.
And
so,
we have more info if you guys are interested. And we also posted a review a while ago. So check that out. They're mm-hmm. really beneficial. No bad side effects. They can only help. So awesome. And on top of that, we mentioned last week that I joined the Astoria Plays Ball League. The games will start at the end of April. I can't wait. And last night, we actually started practicing a little bit as some exercise.
That was a lot of fun.
So much fun. Lisa is like killer. I have to give her props. I mean, I'm not so bad myself.
Thanks.
But we never played together as kids, but we each played in our own perspective mm-hmm. towns growing up.
I missed it a lot. That was really awesome.
And she was a pitcher, but last night, because of her shoulder, she was showing me more of her shortstop skills, and pretty impressive.
Thanks, Mitch.
And we discovered that I could pitch, actually.
You were very, very good. Huh. I was very impressed.
It's fun, so I can't wait till that starts.
And last on the list is the Color Run. So it's May is not too far away. May 31st, the Color Run down at
my mental calendar already has May in it. So yeah,
I know, it's crazy.
We're there.
City Field, May 31st. If you want to join the Color Run, come down, run with us. It's a blast. Seriously. Have a really great time. And then there's like a giant dance party afterwards.
Hurry dance up. Off, dance off. All right. Exercise excitement for the week. So we have our usual routine. We have our Cyclops set up. We have our kettlebell classes. We have our kettlebell DVDs. And we tried Michelle's spin class last week, but Lisa will tell us more about that. And, we would like to try some new dance classes. which would be really cool because we took Michelle's bar class. So basically just we're always trying to try something new, something exciting to keep ourselves going. But when we need to fall back on something at home, like I said, we have our Cyclops and we have our kettlebell, which is awesome. Yeah.
Michelle's spin class was awesome down at the New York Sports Club, which is we also met up with Eric from Connecticut there that night. It was so much fun to get back, and we haven't done spin in years.
I felt like, and this is so cliche, but it was like riding a bike. You know what they say.
It's just like riding a bike. Nice mesh.
Yeah.
It was awesome. She had great music. We had a lot of fun.
It was a full class.
It was a full class. Yes. Every bike was full. So that was cool.
And we're in the midst of the Love Your Jeans Challenge, which is really exciting. We love the kettlebell challenges. They keep you motivated and inspired. You're with a group of people who are doing it along with you from all over the world. Yeah, definitely. Mm-hmm. So the Kettlebell Love Your Jeans Challenge is going on now, and that's going to be followed up with the Love Your Bikini Body Challenge, and then that's going to roll into the 7-day lean. So Dasha and the kettlebell team are getting you summer ready.
Totally ripped.
Yes.
And like we said, you're going to be turning your practices for softball into more of an exercise. We tried to get each other running around last night.
It was fun, yeah. Lisa was throwing me a bunch of grounders, and I definitely got sweaty and got the heart rate up. So
good.
Softball can be a little slow, sedentary, but if you make it more of an activity, then you know it can definitely be a good workout.
So what's going on tomorrow night?
We're going to the CMC, the Civilian Military Combine event at Reebok Fit Hub. I cannot wait. I'm actually really motivated to try to like win a heat.
Wow.
Yeah.
I'm a little nervous. I don't know what to expect.
I don't know
Civilian
what kind of
military combine.
It's
going to
be very much like CrossFit.
Okay.
So there's going to be box jumps. There's going to be kettlebell swings. We know we can swing a kettlebell like none other. There's going to be 15-minute heats. I'm there to stick for the whole event. Check it out. Our friend Teal is going to come with us.
That's right.
And I guess the top men and women will win a pair of new Reebok sneakers.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, so I'm in it to win it.
Awesome.
I'm excited.
Good luck.
Thanks. You might win too. Who knows?
Who knows?
You can box jump like none other.
That's true. On to the hit list. Our song today, I came up with because it just reminded me of what we're going to talk about in just a few minutes on how exercise, other than weight loss, has so many other benefits, one including making you happy. So this week's song is Pharrell Williams, Happy.
It's actually, at first I was like, really? But it's actually really cute.
No, come on, it's so cute.
I like it outside of the context.
I know, and I know that everyone's been overplaying it and everything else on the radio, but
I think it's good.
It's so good. A couple of months from now, when it's done playing on the radio, you're going to put it on, it's going to come up on your playlist, you're going to be like, yeah, this song.
Yeah. I think this is a good song for any kind of workout. I could see it for a hill. It'd be a good hill song.
I think it's great for any workout.
There you go.
It automatically raises my mood every time I listen.
Should we raise the roof, like Michelle would say? Well, we listen to Happy.
So much tension in my shoulders today.
Aw. You need to get happy.
I do.
Could be from all the softball, too.
Could be. So that's that.
Good choice, Lee. And it perfectly goes with
totally
the
theme. Cheesy.
I like it. I think it's a good workout song, so it works. And, you know, we have all sorts of viewers and listeners, so hopefully that resonates with them.
That's sweet.
We got to keep it versatile. We are changing things up on you guys this week.
Uh-oh.
Be alarmed. I am doing the magazine, and Lisa is doing the book. Dun, dun, dun. So we found this really cool article from New York Times Magazine. It's actually from 2012. There were so many articles about this topic that dated back to, like, even 2007. So obviously people have been talking about this for a while. I don't feel like it's always in the mainstream, but I hope that people, you know, listen to what we're saying today and that it does become more popular, because it's a really cool concept when you think about that exercise is not only going to take, you know, help you with weight, help you with your fitness, and help you with, you know, diabetes and heart disease, but it's going to help your brain, which is awesome. So
I need that.
Lee, I mean, I was thinking all the exercise we do, it must have already helped our brain.
I'm not quite sure.
I love it. So basically, this whole article goes into a study that they did with mice. And, you know, usually when I read a study based on mice, I'm just like, oh, okay. But it was actually interesting the way they set it up. So they're basically saying, obviously, that you can exercise as a way to make yourself smarter. So they had four groups of mice. They had one group that was in like a very pleasureful environment with bright colors and, you know, a comfy bed and like great foods, fruits and cheeses. They had another group.
Sounds like those mice were living the life.
Yeah, right. They had another group that had a running wheel in their cages with not as many. Actually, I think they had the same pleasures. This got cut off a little here. The third group held no embellishments. And they received the standard dull kibble. And the fourth group contained the running wheels, but no other toys or treats. Basically, what they found was that the mice that were in that pleasurable environment, mm-hmm. they did not get any smarter. Okay. Their brains did not improve at all. It didn't matter how many toys and tastes they were getting.
Did they get holes in their brain?
I don't know.
As I like read something about that?
Really, no.
I really did.
But it turns out that the only thing that mattered was whether or not these mice had a running wheel in their cage. And the animals that exercised, whether or not they had any other enrichments in their cage, mm-hmm. had healthier brains and performed significantly better on cognitive tests than the other mice. And basically, unless they exercised, they didn't become smarter at all. So,
wow.
They found that exercise seems to slow or reverse the brain's physical decay, much as it does with muscles. Mm-hmm. And basically, the mice and rats that ran for a few weeks generally had about twice as many neurons in their hippocampi as the sedentary animals. And their brains, like their other muscles, were actually bulking up, which was really cool.
I want to know, like, am I exercising wrong? I don't get it.
Well, they do talk about the different types of exercises in some of the articles we found here that can help more than others. Basically, like, an aerobic activity is really good.
Okay.
Walking, things like that. They had done a study in another article I have here. They had one group stretch and one group walked, and the walking group actually performed better when it came to their brain tests later. So people can develop new brain cells. It was thought in the past that they couldn't, but people actually can. But those cells can only improve their intellect if they join an existing neural network. And just developing new brain cells does not mean that you're going to automatically have that cell join an existing network. So they found...
I think that's what's happened to me.
Just wait. They found that the only way to pull neurons into the network is to learn something. Now, with some mice, what they did was they had them do a cognitive task and they had them navigate a maze. And when they navigated the maze, they reactivated those cells. But when they practiced other cognitive skills, they didn't recall those cells again. Okay. It was only the mice who exercise whose neurons became nimble and joined other networks. And then it wasn't that those neurons just activated when they exercised again. They actually activated all the time as well. So like I said here, the mice that run, their brains readily wired many neurons into the neural network, and they didn't fire only during running. They also lit up when the animals practiced cognitive skills. So running, unlike learning, had created brain cells that could multitask.
Wow.
Really cool. Yeah. They talk also about the brain-derived neurotrophic factor. I know that you're going to bring that up in your article as well. Mm-hmm. It strengthens cells and axons in the brain. And they found that after workouts, most people display higher BDNF levels in their bloodstreams. And they're saying that it's not clear if the activity has to be an endurance-type exercise or if it can just be like an intensity exercise. But basically, most studies to date, all animals experiments have involved running or other aerobic activities. So that's kind of cool to know. And they also said that the exercise didn't have to be exhausting for the brain and that the exercise didn't have to be exhausting in general. Basically, like I said, you can just go walking. And they did a study with a group of older people here too. And they said that the walkers had actually, I talked about the walking test.
Right.
They regained 2 years or more of their hippocampal youth. So 65-year-olds had achieved the brains of 63-year-olds simply by walking.
Wow.
Yeah. So if people are worried about, you know, mental decline as they get older, exercise and walking can actually slow your mental decline. So that was that article.
How very cool.
Could lead to a better brain.
Thanks, Mish.
Yeah.
The book.
I have to say the bits just totally helped me with all that, too.
I'm glad.
I'm feeling the bits.
I'm feeling a little crazy right now. Like all over the place. I'm blown away by
Sean feels nothing.
Blown away by the Mises.
30, but
blown away by the Mises. Okay, so the book this week is called The First 20 Minutes by Gretchen Reynolds. And I pulled this from the research that I was doing about the additional benefits of exercise. And in the article I'm going to refer to in just a few minutes, they reference this book. So Gretchen talks about how it's not a matter of like exactly how hard the workout is or how long the workout is. What's important is the first 20 minutes is what's going to improve your health. Thanks, Mish. Just helping you. I'm good. So, you know, the book explains that there's the scientific discoveries that can help us achieve our personal best, all based on the first 20 minutes of exercise.
Cool.
I think this is pretty important. I think it's pretty cool. I mean, look at me. I'm like, oh, all I need is the first 20 minutes. I'm good. No, but seriously, this is all about, you know, exercise is not all about just weight loss. It's about more than that. It can really improve so many facets of your life.
Really?
So
cool.
That is the book, Gretchen Reynolds, The First 20 Minutes.
There's another book I thought that we could do today that actually released today.
Wow.
There's a group called that we follow on Facebook called Paleo for Women.
Mm-hmm.
And the creator of that group authored a book. It's called Sexy by Nature, I believe. And basically, it's an approach to eating whole foods and just like doing what's best for yourself to be sexy rather than like going crazy.
Mm-hmm.
And how like women's bodies will naturally, when they're not in a heightened stress and like overdoing it, mm-hmm. they'll naturally come to their natural sexy state. We'll talk about that another time, but I thought it was cool to mention that book released today as well.
Wow.
Yeah. I'll show you later.
Definitely.
Lisa's like, I want to be sexy by nature. I love it.
Sign me up.
Okay. So the recipe of the week. Oh my gosh. Guys,
God,
this is real life. Lisa made the best freaking imaginable gluten-free Irish soda bread I could have ever imagined. And like she whipped it up in 2.5. This is a photo from Elena's pantry. This is where we found the recipe. Apparently Elena is Jewish and she writes, as a Jew, Irish soda bread would not be something that comes naturally to me. However, over the years, I've received numerous requests for a gluten-free, dairy-free, gum-free, high-protein Irish soda bread. And here you have it. This was so good. I was going to bring some into work, but you do need to toast it. At least I found it to be better toasted.
Sure.
With a little bit of butter. Basically, it's just almond flour, sea salt, baking soda, raisins, eggs, agave nectar or honey, apple cider vinegar, and caraway seeds. And I believe it's the apple cider vinegar that reacts to give it that soda bread.
That's what I tasted in it.
So she said, I use apple cider vinegar in this recipe for the acid rather than mm-hmm. buttermilk. We loved it. We ordered some corned beef and cabbage last night, and we had our sourdough bread with it. I don't want to say it's completely guilt-free.
No.
But it was definitely a nice treat, and it didn't have as much guilt.
Huh.
So we will post the Irish soda bread recipe. We really enjoyed that. Happy St. Patrick's Day.
Happy St. Patrick's Day.
A day late to everyone there.
Definitely. And the cheat of the week are the almond butter dark chocolate chip cookies from Fast Paleo, which we brought in.
I think these are even better than the real deals. I'm obsessed with these.
You like them better than the real deals? Are you going to have one?
Yeah, everyone here at work liked them too.
I'm glad.
Yeah.
So they're so simple. Fastest chocolate chip cookies I've ever whipped up.
Shauna.
Where's my recipe? 5 steps and then they're in the oven. Okay,
they were so quick.
Oh, and actually, one of the steps is to preheat the oven. So really, it's just 4 steps. It's just a cup of almond butter, 1/3 cup of honey, 1 egg, 1 tablespoon of vanilla, a half a teaspoon of salt, 1/2 teaspoon of baking soda,
cookies.
1/4 teaspoon of baking powder, and 2/3 cup of shredded unsweetened coconut, and 1/2 cup of dark chocolate chips. I mean, if you don't want to use the dark chocolate, you can use milk chocolate, same stuff.
I saw someone use white chocolate.
I actually wound up throwing in both milk and dark in my second batch.
We even had milk chocolate?
Yeah, the Enjoy Life.
Sweet? Oh.
The Enjoy Life chips. Oh, they are?
Yeah.
Oh, oops. Anyway.
I think what gives them their great texture, because they have no flour. Did she mention there's absolutely no flour in these?
There's no flour.
The coconut is what really gave them that flour feel, right?
Mm-hmm.
When you're making the batter. Sorry, she's chewing.
The almond butter and the honey come together and it becomes like it thickens. Like you can like watch it thicken. And then once you put the coconut in, it's like it even just becomes like, oh, wow, this is really cookie dough. Because at first you're like, uh-oh. This doesn't look like cookie dough. And then like slowly it sort of like reacts with one another and it works.
The dough even tastes like cookie dough.
Yeah, I think it's because of the almond butter and the honey.
Nice. We made them on Saturday. It's Tuesday. I mean, they're still good. I don't know how many more days that we would get out of them because I guess they don't have anything to keep them really soft.
Mm-hmm.
They're a little crunchy, but I love them. So Good job with the cheat of the weekly.
Thanks.
So the weekly theme, which we've talked a couple of times about, is about the additional benefits of exercise. So we often associate exercise solely with weight loss, but exercise has other hidden benefits that should also be uncovered. It's not just about bulking up, getting muscles, losing weight. It's not just about, you know, all the way you look. It's not about doing what's trendy. It's not about doing what you think you should do or disease prevention. It is about all those things. But on top of that, I don't know if you've ever noticed how amazing exercise makes you feel. As much as I don't sometimes even want to go to the gym or go do my workout, by the end of the workout, I feel like a completely different person.
And I mean, sometimes I want to attribute it to the fact that I'm just proud of myself for completing it. But when I read all of this stuff and I was like, oh, you know what? That's kind of true.
Mm-hmm. Runner's high is a real thing. And they said if you actually test it out, when you do a series of sprints for 30 seconds for five times during a run, they say you'll feel sparkly all day.
Oh, I want to feel sparkly.
I know. I want to feel sparkly.
Sparkly, sexy, naturally.
Lisa's getting so excited.
Sean, too.
We basically want to feel how Sean feels all day, every day.
That's
sparkly,
true.
Sexy. The energy bits are making me feel a little sparkly.
Maybe even
a little sexy.
Blah, 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 blah.
I love it. So the article we found is the article that kind of stemmed our
excitement
for the
today.
Show. And Lisa's going to get into that for us.
It's called What Happens to Our Brains When We Exercise and How It Makes Us Happier by Leo Woodrich. So it breaks it down. Exercise is a cure for depression. It helps memory loss. Alzheimer's disease and Parkinson's. We'll talk about that a little bit later. But that's exercise can do those things. And what happens when in the brain when you exercise is that a moment of stress is recognized, your heart pressure increases, and all of a sudden your body's in like a fight or a flight mode, and it releases brain-derived neurotrophic factor. A protective and reparative element sent to your memory neurons, and it acts as a reset switch, which results in feeling at ease and a clear mind after exercising. You're feeling happy, and endorphins are released, which minimize discomfort, blocks pain, and is also associated with a feeling of euphoria. So we actually have a picture of what the brain looks like sedentary, and then after a 20-minute walk. I mean, it's just a 20-minute walk. We're not even talking about, like, you know, high-intensity interval training here. We're talking about a 20-minute walk.
Imagine what it must look like after Janelle's workout.
But this picture was also in the article, which I found to be absolutely fascinating. So look at all that activity going on in your brain. And like Michelle had said from the New York Times Magazine article, you know, you're creating, you know, new cells, and you know, this is what helps keep your brain healthy, and keeps your, you know, the issue with memory loss and Alzheimer's disease down the line as you get older. So BDFN and endorphins have addictive behavior, and like I had said back in, you know, back with the book review, studies show the first 20 minutes of activity provide, you know, the most health benefits: prolonged life, reduced disease risk. So that came from the book by Gretchen as well. And a quick last fact. You get the highest level of happiness with exercise if you were just starting out. So, you know, we exercise quite often, which is a great thing. But we're not going to feel that, like, super duper happy right after, you know, we exercise, because it's more of like a normal thing for us. So we probably experience, you know, a couple other things. And as far as, you know, we're working on keeping depression out of our lives and memory loss as well, which is a good thing.
Well, yeah, I mean, that's something we suffer from anyway, but it generally will keep us happier, which is cool, and help our brains down the road when we're older, which is awesome. And it's always good to be, you know, because we're at an age now where we're not in school anymore.
Right.
So if we're doing exercise and it's going to help us when we do need to learn something, it's going to keep our brains nimble. And I think the really cool fact is that those new brain cells are actually working. They're interacting and they're joining other neural chains rather than just staying there unused. So
it's important.
It's one of my favorite things about learning all of this. So
I really hope that it's that's working for me. Maybe I need to like try to learn something on the top of exercise.
I mean, I don't necessarily agree that we don't still feel that high, because I do. I know I do.
I'm with you with that.
So, I mean, maybe it depends on the type of exercise you're doing more so as well. But at least to know if you are starting a new routine, get excited, because you're going to feel amazing.
Yeah, you're going to feel great.
But that just know that that might wane off a little bit over time is basically what they're saying.
Right.
So we also found an article that has the 7 mind-blowing benefits of exercise. Exercise is the single best thing you can do for your brain in terms of mood, memory, and learning. Even 10 minutes of activity changes your brain. And they're going to give us 5 ways that exercise can boost your brain power here. And this is from US News. So the first one is it reverses the detrimental effects of stress, which is really, really cool. Jumping on the treadmill or cross trainer for 30 minutes can blow off tension by increasing levels of soothing brain chemicals like serotonin, dopamine, and norepinephrine. 3 times there, guys. It's been a while since I've done that. It's a good one. You like that, Sean? Should I try it 3 times fast? And also, exercise may actually work on a cellular level to reverse stress's toll on our aging process. So all the stressing that we do sometimes, we're actually aging. And if you exercise more...
I know. I've noticed a lot more gray hairs, let me tell you.
Really? I haven't noticed. So they said that stressed out women who exercise vigorously for an average of 45 minutes over a 3-day period had cells that showed fewer signs of aging than compared to women who were stressed out and inactive. And also, my favorite part of this whole thing was that the working out also helps keep us from ruminating, meaning brewing over something, thinking of the same thing over and over again, because it alters the blood flow to those areas in the brain involved in triggering us to relive these stressful thoughts again and again. So it's going to keep you from having ruminating, obsessive, stressful thoughts. Pretty darn cool.
That's a cool word.
Ruminating, yes. The second benefit is that it lifts depression, like Lisa had said. So research suggests that burning off 350 calories 3 times a week through sustained sweat-inducing activity can reduce symptoms of depression about as effectively as antidepressants. Exercise appears to stimulate the growth of neurons in certain brain regions that are damaged by depression. So you're actually going to stimulate growth in those areas again, which is cool. And it'll act as a natural antidepressant when you boost the production of brain molecules that improve connections between the nerve cells. They said that yoga can be used to complement, not substitute, drug treatment for depression. It's always nice to have to not take medicine.
Absolutely. Really cool. We try not to take any pills.
And we don't advocate for you to give up your depression medication, but to maybe supplement the exercise with it. It'll help you.
Definitely.
It improves learning. Exercise increases the level of brain chemicals called growth factors, which help make new brain cells, which we talked about. Playing tennis or taking a dance class will actually provide the biggest brain boost. Yes.
Oh, my God.
Because you're challenging your brain to think about coordination as well. Complicated activities improve our capacity to learn by enhancing our attention and concentration skills. So they said that high school students scored better on high attention tasks after doing 10 minutes of a complicated fitness task, rather than 10 minutes of regular activity. And those who didn't exercise at all obviously scored the worst. Exercise, like you had said, does build self-esteem and improve body image. So one of the reasons you do feel good is that you feel good about yourself.
Right.
And they said that simply seeing fitness improvements like running a faster mile, lifting more weight than before, can improve your self-esteem and body image. It leaves you feeling euphoric, which you talked about. And this is where they mentioned the sprint bursts. So if you run, bike, or swim as fast as you can for 30, 40 seconds, and then reduce your speed to a gentle pace for 5 minutes before sprinting again, repeat this for a total of 5 sprints, you'll feel sparkly for the rest of the day.
Sparkly, sparkly.
It keeps the brain fit. Again, leisurely walk can help your brain keep it fit and active, fending off memory loss and keeping skills like vocabulary retrieval strong. And finally, it may keep Alzheimer's at bay, which I think is really cool. They said that exercise is one of the best weapons against the disease. They did a test with elderly people. They found that the hippocampus, which governs memory and spatial navigation, is one of the first brain regions to succumb to Alzheimer's. That is actually a region that you will improve when you exercise. A daily walk or jog could lower the risk, and if you do get Alzheimer's, it can blunt the impact once it's begun.
Really?
If you're starting to feel the effects, if you exercise, it can help out. So
that's really
seven
that's
mind-blowing benefits. Yes.
I have to say that this greatest 13 unexpected benefits of exercise is very, very similar to what you just read.
There's a couple of extra things, I think.
Yes, and I will just point out those. So greatest has 13 unexpected benefits of exercise. Well, you get a chance to enjoy the great outdoors.
Well, yeah.
Get out. But, you know, the whole preventing the cognitive decline is super important. And just another fact on this, especially if you exercise between the age of 25 and 45, it boosts the chemicals in the brain that support and prevent degenerative of the hippocampus. Could you imagine?
Hippocampus.
Doctors, right? Mm-hmm. These words. Crazy. Which is an important, it's just the hippocampus, for those of us who don't know, is an important part of the brain for memory and learning. It also boosts the brain power, like we said with the Mises.
The Mises.
They studied mice and men. Of mice and men. Have shown that cardiovascular exercise can create new brain cells. So I need to get more cardio in my life, maybe. Mm-hmm. Maybe that's what it is.
I think that's what it is.
I think that's what it is.
Is that what it is?
I think that's what it is.
I think it's what it is.
It also helps control addiction, which...
I think that's awesome.
Exercise can distract you from whatever, you know, like Michelle said, the ruminating and whatnot. I mean, obsessing over things and, you know, keep an addict from thinking about what they really, really want, Sean.
Sean turns with his indoor cigarette and a bottle of beer.
He's like, really? Sean, it's time to start exercising.
I have to say I agree with that, though, because when it just comes to food.
Yes.
When we're exercising a lot.
Because, you know, you're thinking about, like, oh, I really want to eat, blah, blah, blah. You know, like, so, but then you exercise and you're like, oh, hey, it feels so good. Mm-hmm. Like, that just happened.
Now to eat something really good and healthy. Yeah.
And you get more done. And if you're feeling uninspired in your cubicle, the solution might just be to take a short walk or a jog, you know, on your lunch hour. And it says that research shows that that workers who take time for exercise on a regular basis are more productive and have more energy than their sedentary peers. So I've maybe made too much of a habit of walking around the floor these days.
And I know there's a few.
And I'm not getting any work done, but that's fine.
There's a few other cool ones in there, but we'll definitely post that.
Absolutely.
So on to some tips. You might be thinking, great, guys, thanks for all of these things that tell me that exercise is awesome for me, but I still don't feel like I have time to fit it in, or I don't know how to fit it in. So how can you get in the habit of exercising daily? Now you're like, okay, I want to feel good. Maybe I suffer from anxiety or depression and I want to help that out, or whatever it is. You're like, I don't want to get Alzheimer's. And it doesn't matter how old you are. Maybe you have a parent or a grandparent and you want to tell them the benefits and go for a walk with them. We thought of some kind of cool ways that you can make it a habit daily. So put your gym clothes right over your alarm clock or phone when you go to bed to remind you to not hit the snooze bar when you wake up. This way you know the first thing you're going to feel is your gym shorts or your t-shirt or your sports bra.
You're like, oh, I'm doing that.
Yeah.
That's right.
And I'm going to get up
this
and do that.
This is happening.
So I'm actually going to try that tonight and see if that does the trick for me tomorrow.
But you don't have an alarm clock.
I can't hit that snooze button anymore. I got to put that phone across the room or something. Track your exercises and log them at the same time after every exercise. So keep yourself accountable. Watch your progress. That's something we used to do in CrossFit. We would keep track of each workout of the day, and we would see how well we did over time. And if there was an exercise or a WOD that we repeated, we could look back and say, wow, look at where we were when we started and look at where we are now. So to see that improvement, it's really encouraging. Think about starting small and then start even smaller. So baby steps. Get yourself going the littlest way that you can. You know, if you think, okay, I want to train for a 5K. No, I want to start by just getting out there for a walk or getting out there for, you know, a light jog. So
that was from Leo's article. He said he started with 5 minutes a day of exercise.
That's great. That's just to get it in.
5 minutes.
And the article that we had mentioned before said you only need 10 minutes. So give yourself 3 to 4 weeks to make it stick. We often give up way too early. We get sick of it. We don't see results. Our bodies need time to adjust to the new habit mentally. Our brains need time to adjust. And our physique will need time to adjust. If you're just starting out, you'll definitely see results physically right away. But give yourself time to you know, get used to that routine. Try to remember how good it makes you feel at the end and push yourself. This is so major for Lisa and I. Yes. There'll be some nights we'll be dragging. We've had a long day. We have really long days. We try to fit in a lot. Mm-hmm. And sometimes we're like, we just don't feel like it. We'd rather go home and relax or go get something to eat. But when we're done, we're like, woohoo, what are we doing now?
It doesn't even matter what time it is. We're like, we did it.
And we feel amazing. So try to remember that good feeling and push yourself. And finally, make it a non-negotiable on your calendar. Put it on your calendar. Make it a weekly plan. Even if you have to sit down every Sunday night and say, okay, these are the days I can fit it in this week. That's my time. It's important. And another article I'm going to mention in a little bit talks about how it's too often that we put exercise and health last on the list, and it really should be first.
Absolutely. So. Because it can do so many great things for you and your brain. You can succeed at your job because you're exercising, because your brain is growing.
It's great.
Okay.
Growing.
Growing.
What happens if it grows too big?
Now you're getting scientific.
Okay.
Okay, so 23 ways to get more out of your workout routine from greatest.
Greatest.
I'm just going to run through a couple of these. Mm-hmm. Commit. Yoda said it best. Do or do not, there is no try. It's true. Don't walk that line of, oh, I'm going to get physically fit. I'm going to.
Just do it.
Just do it.
As Nike said.
Knock it off. Just do it. Make a plan. Like we said before. You know, and especially when you go to the gym, know what you're going to do. Don't like dance around the machines and being like, oh, what am I going to do? I just don't know what I'm going to do. I mean, I guess I'll do the treadmill. I mean, I guess I'll do like 10 minutes on the elliptical.
Also, that's going to waste a lot of your time.
Right.
And you're on the being there for 2 or 3 hours.
You have that kind of time, remember?
Like, I can't go to the gym because every time I go, I'm there for three hours.
I'm there for 3 hours.
And I just don't have time for that. Well, if you had a plan.
Just stick to it.
You could get in and out.
Stay on schedule. Habits don't just happen, they're formed, and it's true. If you get in the habit, all of a sudden it's second nature. It's like, bam, it's 5:30, I'm off to the gym, see you later. Not like, it's 5:30, maybe I'll go home and get some takeout, or maybe I'll work out. Just get in the habit.
Bring your clothes.
Second nature. Track your progress, said that before. Mm-hmm. Ask for help. Don't risk injuries, okay? So just like find somebody at the gym, or if you know, ask your instructor, hey, how do I do this? Okay, I don't want to hurt myself. Warm up, always. Proper warm up is important. Show and tell. You know, at some point it's going to get old. So if you're frustrated, you know, find a family member or a friend, tell them your frustrations, and maybe they can give you, you know, some tips or encouragement on how to, you know, improve your workout and increase your willpower to keep going. Compete. You know, you can join a competition, fitness competition, if you want. And sometimes just competing against ourselves is the best way to perform better. And do you. Okay, you know, maybe you want the, you know, I always say, like, I want the perfect six pack. But really, it's more about being fit and not flawless. It is.
It's true.
It is very, very true. Because then you're going to, you know, you're going to try. And if you don't reach your goal, you know, as soon as you want to, you may get discouraged.
That's right.
Yeah. So we'll post more of these on the website.
And you might be wondering too, I don't know what time is the best time to exercise, you know, now that I have this whole routine set. Basically, I found this really cool article from Mark's Daily Apple. And Mark does say at the end of the day, you're going to exercise whatever time works best for you. But since we're talking about the benefits of exercising your brain, I thought it'd be interesting to talk about the benefits on the time of the day that you do work out. So he examines the effect of, and he calls it diurnal variation. That's just another fancy way to say time of day.
Wow.
Variations in time of day. But the effect of diurnal variation on various aspects of exercise. So if you're interested in performance, some evidence seems to point toward the afternoon and early evening as the best time to exercise. So he basically found that morning workouts are going to require longer warm-ups if performance is what you're looking for. For sprinting, he said, try afternoons for maximal power, but don't think you'll have any extra stamina. They found that maximal power was highest during the first 3 sprints of 10 total in the afternoon when compared to the morning sprints, but basically fatigability was the same. So whether it was the morning or the afternoon, you're going to get just as tired. Another cycling study found that afternoon power output was greater than morning power output in trained cyclists, and fatigue as well was not affected by the time of day. Basically, the takeaway was for raw power and performance in weightlifting, cycling, and sprinting, they found that the power is highest in the evening, but stamina does not increase or decrease. So basically, if you really only have time in the morning, it's fine. But if you're really looking for intense power, then try to fit it in the morning or the, in the afternoon or evening. Hormonal effects, which I thought was interesting. They found that heavy lifting was better in the evening as opposed to the morning. This is for strength and size building. And this is because of cortisol. So apparently when we wake up in the morning, our cortisol levels are really high because we require that in order to help us wake up.
Oh.
And so when the cortisol levels are already high and then we stress ourselves by exercising,
then there's more.
Cortisol can raise even more.
Mm-hmm.
So this might be why sometimes we have a hard time getting going in the morning.
Well, it's just a great excuse for me not to get exercise. Not true.
But they basically said that if you did have a really bad night's sleep, save the workout for the afternoon,
okay,
and that your cortisol levels are going to be lower in the afternoon, so it's going to be better overall. So they said, don't hop directly under the bar in your pajamas with bleary eyes. Take the time to wake up and relax before working out. We know that cortisol is elevated in the mornings and exercise increases cortisol, so be aware of how they interact. For your health, there's mixed results. Evening walkers had lower fat mass despite eating larger breakfasts. But basically they said the evening walkers did better overall in this test. And,
I'm going to be an evening walker.
They talked here also about the neuroprotective effects of exercise. And basically they said the afternoon session increased it more than the early morning session. So overall, the afternoon and evening kind of seems to win here.
I'm liking that a lot.
And they said that resistance training improved platelet function. It didn't matter what time of the day. Morning and afternoon sessions were equally beneficial. So the takeaway is that evening and afternoon sessions seem to be somewhat more protective and beneficial, but morning sessions are also helpful, just less so. Basically, like I said, whenever you're going to get it in, get it in. And finally, he talked about sleep. And they did find that a 5 p.m. 30-minute session of moderate exercise improved sleep in elderly patients who normally had trouble falling asleep. They fell asleep faster and enjoyed greater satisfaction with the quality of their sleep. I agree with this 100%.
Mm-hmm.
When we work out, it doesn't matter what time of day, but in the evening generally we do, I feel great and I sleep really well too. So basically they said, don't worry about how it impacts your sleep unless you feel that you feel a difference. And we'll post this. There's some more really cool stuff that he talks about. But ultimately, like I said, he said the best time of day to exercise is the time that works for you. So don't get too twisted about it. If you have specific goals,
don't get twisted.
There might be some things of interest for you here. And we're going to post one more thing, and we're not going to get into it now. But it was from the same website as Lisa's original article that inspired the show.
Mm-hmm.
It's called The Creative Brain on Exercise. And it talked all about how artists and creative types and entrepreneurs benefit from exercise, and how all too often they say, I'm too busy, I don't even have time to do my work. But basically, if they were to try to fit the exercise into their schedule,
it benefit their work,
they'd see greater output.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a specific writer that they talk about here, where when he's writing a novel, he gets up every day, he writes for 6 hours, he runs a 10K.
Ooh.
He does like his research. And then he goes to bed at 9 every day for 6 months to a year. And he writes his novel this way. And he runs
the 10. Is he John Grisham?
I mean, 10K is only... How many miles is 10K?
Six miles. Is he Stephen King?
No, his name is Haruki Murakami.
Okay.
Really interesting method. And he talks about how it's not only a mental exercise in writing his novel, but it's a physical endurance test as well. He does this routine the same exact way for 6 months to a year. If I could run a 10K every day for 6 months to a year,
could you imagine what I'd
have the time
like
for that?
I would look naturally sexy.
You do look naturally sexy. I love it. So we'll post that as well. Hopefully we covered all bases.
Sexy by nature.
Okay. Naughty by nature. Not because I hate you. Throwback Tuesday.
CBT.
Love it. And that was all I had for you there.
Very nice, Mitch. Well, feel free to contact us for any additional information on any of the things we spoke about today.
I feel like that show really flew by today.
It did.
Tabata of the week.
Ooh.
Was that loud? Sorry. I got excited. Energy bits. Hashtag powered by bits.
Hashtag.
So this week,
Tabata.
I did a little searching around the internet to get a little inspiration, and I just came up with something different. I feel like we're going to do 20 seconds of jump rope with mm-hmm. a 10 second break, 20 seconds of a low planked push-up. So what you're going to do is you're going to get yourself into a low plank, put yourself into a high plank, do a push-up, then go back into a low plank. So you're going to alternate between the low plank and the push-up. That's for 20 seconds with a 10-second break. Then you're going to do 20 seconds of speed skaters with a 10-second break. And then since we're doing a side-to-side, we also have to do a front-to-back. So we're going to do 20 seconds of reverse lunges with a 10-second break. And you're going to repeat that for a total of 4 minutes. And if you're still not sure about the benefits of a Tabata, Google it. Check out the Tabata Timer Pro app and give it a go.
It's going to make your brain
grow. It is going to help your brain and your bod. Your brain and your bod.
Oh, boy.
Thanks for joining us for our show this week. As always,
thanks, everybody.
A huge thank you to Skinny Man and 3-1 and Sean O for his help with the production of our show. Join us for our next show next Tuesday, March 25th. And remember,
choose, commit, challenge, and change.
Thanks, guys. Have a great night.
Have a great night. Hold your head high, fingers to the sky. Even some can try it, but they can't deny it. Keep it moving higher and higher. Keep it moving higher and higher. So hold your head high, fingers to the sky. Now they don't believe ya, but they're gonna need ya. Keep it moving higher and higher. Keep it moving higher and higher.